Hello guys, we're just going to wait one more minute just for a couple more people to get on the stream and then we'll get started. You're going to need a pen and a piece of paper ready to go. Okay, I think that's just good to go. How's it going? Nice to see you. My name is Mark. I don't know if we already met, but hello. I'm a poet. I'm a rapper. I'm a rap battler as well. I also write stories and I make documentaries and bits and pieces. And I'm like you. I'm kind of locked down in my house at the moment, and I miss having people to perform for and people to work with. So I thought maybe I could try and help you guys every Tuesday or Wednesday morning, and I could kind of read you guys a piece, and I could show you some of the skills that you would need to improve your writing and to kind of move on to that next stage. Now, I used to be a secondary school English teacher and a head of year as well, back in the day. That was nearly a decade ago. And the last 10 years I've spent trying to hone and focus what I learned as a teacher and kind of really focus on the creative writing side of things and how to kind of push those things. So it's really nice to see you guys. I've just run a workshop for Key Stage 1 and 2. And for you guys, some of the activities we're going to cover today are actually similar to the activities that I covered with them. And the reason we're going to cover them is because I actually think I found in schools, as you get older, some of these things get harder to do. I actually find with adults, some of these things are really hard because we start to worry about getting things wrong. So what I'm going to do today, I'm going to read you guys a rap to start off with. You're going to need a pen and a piece of paper ready to go once I've done the rap. And we're going to look at exploring originality, avoiding cliche, and why those things are really important to us. So I hope we're good. Nice to see you guys. I think I've got some ex-students who have popped on to say hello. Gosh, I'm making us all feel old, aren't I? But okay, so are you ready? This is a rap. I'm going to read. I wrote this rap because back when I was teaching a student that I taught, he was in year 7 and his name was Jordan. And he said to me one day at the end of an English lesson, he said, "Sir, no offense, but you are the least cool teacher in the whole school." And I said, what do you mean? I'm super cool. And he said, "No, you're not, sir. Cool people don't say super cool and they don't write poems. Poems are not cool. If you want to be cool, you should write a rap. That'd be much cooler." And I said, "Well, I can write you a rap." And he said, "No, you can't, sir. If you do, it'll be weird. Like, rappers are tough and they're dangerous and you're not tough and you're not dangerous. And if you try and rap, it will be embarrassing." And I said, "Well, I can write you a rap about being tough and dangerous." And he said, "Well, you'd be lying though, sir." So I went away and I thought, could I write a rap about being tough and dangerous where I'm also kind of telling the truth? And I came up with this. So the truth is, I am quite tough and I am quite dangerous when I'm playing board games and card games. Like, I win every year when we play Monopoly. That's what I rapped about. Now, I don't know if you think you're good at board games and card games, but here's the challenge. I perform this in loads of schools. People like to try and count how many board games and card games are in the rap. So I'm going to perform it to you. Feel free to count along as it goes. Type the answer if you'd like to in the comment thread so I can see that you're with me as we're going through this. Whoever is the closest, I will give them a round of applause and celebrate their incredible social life on the thread. All right, so you ready to count? Yep, ready to count. But you ready? All right, so it goes like this. "Yeah, you boys in the hood think you're up to no good, but skills with a dice are lame. I'll top trump you weak punks, you'll get trashed. Inca plunk, yeah, I'm really, 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 really good at board games. I'm like an MB innovation, rolling dice, dishing cards without any reservation. When it comes to risk, I tell you this, I am the global nation coming at you through Kamchatka like a cannon infestation, a Stone Age deforestation. I give mousetrap demonstrations and every game of operation is like a military operation. Used to make the observation, nothing trivial in my pursuit. I'm cracking skulls every evening when I'm out of my suit, playing the odds on Pirate's Cove, stealing your booty. I did pretty well on Atmosphere, though that DVD was spooky. I don't care about a loss against you in Call of Duty, because I beat you in Guess Who when I was Sue and you were James. That's because I'm really, 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 really good at board games. If it's Punch Out, I'll split your lip. If it's poker, I'll take each chip. Buckaroo, I'll make you make him kick. Then lightning quick, your fan have sunk your battleship. I fry bacon when I play past the pigs till you wee, wee, wee all the way home. And my meeple are lethal in each game of Carcassonne. I'm in the zone in Monopoly, just no stopping me. Hopping over pieces of that little silver doggy. Stabbing the Irish looking rubbish property on Mayfair again. Oh, what will you offer me? Because you boys think you're tight. Think you're up for a fight, but you clearly aren't prepared for the pain. I'll dice you up as long as it ain't a school night. I'm really, 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 really good at board games." There we go. That's the wrap. So have you been counting? Have you got an idea how many you think there are in it? Jesse has come in with 26. Yeah, I mean, possibly. I'll give you like a few seconds to kind of think about what you kind of think whilst you're, feel free to put the number in the side, and I'm going to bring up our first task, which will be based upon we got a few. 46. That's ambitious. I like it. It's a little bit low. Oh, Lila's going with 20. Very interesting. Very interesting indeed. Let's see what we have got. Oh, we got more coming in. 12. Oh, okay, okay, okay. We got a few. Ha ha. Oh, cheers, Dan. Pleased that you did. Yeah, you're very welcome to check out my battle stuff. It's a little bit risque. But yeah, okay, cool. So, okay, we got a few answers. I think our closest that I've had on here so far, we got Lila, we got 20. The answer is in that performance. There were 18. Yes, 18. So congratulations. That was the closest that we've got. So Claire, we got 16. That's pretty close as well. You kind of tied on it. Well done. Okay, so here's the thing. When I wrote that rap, I just wrote it for a student and that was about it. But I performed it and people liked it. And then I had people message after I did the gig and they said, oh, could you read that at this event? We've got an event. Could you come and read it there? And I went to that event and then other people saw it and they said, could you read it here? And now often when I get booked anywhere, people, when I turn up and I say to the teachers, oh, is there anything you'd like me to do? Or I turn up if I'm doing a gig in London or something. And people kind of go, oh, could you do that board games rap one? Because they remember it. And I think the reason they remember it and they ask me to perform it is because it is original. Okay, it's something that is not a copy. It's the first of its kind. I don't think anyone else has written a rap about board games. And I think a lot of the things that I've done as an artist, I've always thought about this being at the top. I think for me, someone mentioned rap battling earlier on. For me, I thought that the rap battle scene in the UK was like really exciting at a point when there was a lot of originality. There was a lot of kind of unusual different stuff going on within battling. And that meant there was a lot of experimentation and it was really cool. Now in English, this is always the highest grade at GCSE. The very top grades often have like originality and flair. And it's considered very difficult to do, to try and write an essay or a piece of descriptive writing where you're saying something that is different, that is not like anybody else's. I have gone to lots of schools and sometimes I've even met teachers who have told me they don't think that you can improve this, that it's just something that happens. I don't think that's true. I think you can improve this. I think you can get better at being original. And I think you can get worse at being original as well. And today, that's what we're going to focus on. Now, I have done a lot of this stuff with the younger years, as I said, but it's because this is the most important thing I think you have to cover before we move on to the next stage. In order to be original, we have to acknowledge that we have to show this as well. Resilience. It's the other quality that's really important. Okay, because this is so hard and what we're saying is different and sometimes a bit weird and we're not sure how it's going to come across, we start to worry that we're making a mistake or we kind of panic. And that's when people start copying other people or writing stuff that isn't original. All right, so we need resilience. And today I'm going to test you the ability to not give up, even if something gets difficult. And today I'm going to test you on your ability to be resilient. All right, and to have all these original ideas. Now, to start off with, we're going to start nice and easy. I'm going to give you a task. You're going to need a pen and a piece of paper. This is a task I like running with a lot of people. We're going to just focus on how to work out what this looks like, I think, first of all, so we can see it. So what I'm going to do is this. I'm going to give you a task. You're going to have 1 minute to complete this task. That is it. And for this task, I want you to not worry about being an original, amazing writer. We're not looking at that. I just want you to do something very simple for me, which is write a list of things you did this morning before this session started. Okay, really simple list. Just things you did this morning before the session started now. I've written my own list and I'm going to read it out and we'll see how you do in contrast to that. So I'm going to give you 1 minute, a list of things on average. Key stage 3, we get about 6 things. Key stage 4, you should breeze this. I'm expecting like 7 or 8 minimum. Things you did this morning before the session started, your time starts now. Thank you. Okay, so list of things that you did this morning before this session started. Hopefully you've managed to get a bunch of things. If you're still finishing one, get it finished now. That's totally fine. Cool. So we've got some things that we've done this morning before the session started. I've written my own list of things that I did before this session started, and I'm going to read out what I've got on my list. What I'd like you guys to do is I want you to put a cross next to each thing on your list that I read out. So if you hear something, please put a cross next to it on your own list. We're going to see how many people have got the same thing as me. So first off, I woke up. Did you do that? Put a cross next to it. So I slept. I got dressed. I had a shower. I brushed my teeth. I fed my dog. I stroked my dog. I got licked a lot by my dog. I looked at my phone. I went to the toilet. Some helpful information for you there. I watched TV. I went. And I printed lots and lots of pages out for this workshop. Now, those are my things. And hopefully, some of those things you were putting crosses next to because you had them on your list. I find when I run this, a lot of people put down, I had breakfast, because a lot of people have breakfast, which is good, right? A lot of people put down, I woke up, and I got dressed. And when I read poems, it's a bit like this as well, though. A lot of people say the same things. I think whenever we get a cross, and you've said something that's the same as someone else, I think it's cliche, right? It's the opposite of original. Anytime you've got a cross or you say something the same as someone else, you have written something that is not original. It's not the first of its kind. It's not different. It is just instead cliche. And I think all the crosses you've got on your piece of paper, for me, I think are less helpful in our writing than the ones that we have not got crossed. In fact, when I'm doing this and I'm focusing on this, we tend to find that people get on average about three or more crosses. I don't know how you did. So here's the thing. Doing this and not doing this is hard because we're used to cliches. We're used to try and copy things and we get used to kind of saying the same thing as other people. Particularly, I find when we get into key stage four, actually, we start to worry, I think, in life that we're kind of like standing out or looking a bit weird or looking a bit different somehow. And so we try really hard to be the same as everybody else. And that's not helpful for us as writers. So what I'm going to do this time is I'm going to set you a challenge. I'm going to ask you to write something different. And this time I want you to write something that is not like anybody else's, not like I would write. I want you to write me a list of things that you wish you had done today. All right, things that you wish you had done. They could be impossible things you could say. For example, I wish I'd been roller skating on the moon with Donald Trump. I don't know why you would want to do that, but you could say that. My favorite one is still my favorite one, been for a while now. Someone once wrote, I wish I had been waxing a squirrel, which I really liked. I thought that was really, really good because it was a combination of words I'd never heard before. And it's quite a striking image, right? It was a very original combination of words. There are three rules for these wishes. Rule number one is that you're not allowed to kill anyone. I know, I apologize. It's just because someone always puts down, I wish I'd killed Justin Bieber or Donald Trump. Actually, that happens quite a lot. But like that happens in writing a lot. But because someone always puts it down, you could put a cross next to it if someone read it out on yours. It would be cliche. It wouldn't be original. So we're not going to do that. All right. So we're not going to kill anyone. Rule number two, it's called number two for a reason. Someone always puts down something rude. Like there's always someone that really wants to write about wee and poo and farts. If that's you, like, great. You can make loads of money writing about wee and poo and farts. But someone always thinks to put it down. It won't be original. So what we're going to do is we are going to not mention wee. We're not going to mention poo. We're not going to farts. And the third rule, most important rule, is you're not allowed to mention roller skating. You're not allowed to mention the moon. You're not allowed to mention Donald Trump. Excellent. You're not allowed to mention waxing or squirrels, and you're not allowed to mention any of those things, because I've said them already. And the problem we've got is that whenever we say something that is someone else has said, it's going to be cliche, right? Because you're saying something that someone else has already come up with. It's not going to be the first of its kind. It's not going to be original. Okay, I don't care how serious or how silly or how weird or how unusual these ideas are. What I want to see is whether you can write something that, if you were to put it on the thread here, no one else on the thread could have thought to put it down. All right, no one could put a cross next to it. So I'm going to give you 3 minutes to see how many ideas you can get, original ideas, things that you wish you had done that no one else could think of. Let's go. Okay, so we've had a bit of time. Hopefully we've started to think of some original wishes and dreams and ideas, things that we would like to do. Maybe you've thought of something you'd like to eat that no one would ever think they'd want to eat, or maybe you've kind of put down somewhere you'd like to go. Often, I'll give you a little bit of a warning, whenever anyone does this, the first thing they tend to think about is, I wish I'd been skydiving. Someone always says, I wish I'd been skydiving. So if you've got skydiving, count that as a cross. See if you can do anything with that to make that a little bit more unusual. Sometimes I get people writing, I wish I rode a pig to school, or I wish I rode I wish I rode to Australia on the back of a huge lizard and then had a barbecue with a kangaroo. Cool. Barbecue with a kangaroo is lovely. I actually think barbecue with a kangaroo, that's a pretty good name for a collection of children's poems. I think that's a nice idea. And you should find that the things you've come up with, all the kind of like images and ideas you come up with, are much more interesting than that very first list. Now, I sometimes take these ideas and I try and turn them into titles for poems. I'm just scribbling about and I think, right, now I could take one of these ideas and I could turn it into a title for a poem. Posh Win at Wembley. Great, that's a great idea for a poem. You could write about it or a story. I wish I'd built a snowman. Yeah, great. That's a nice idea at the moment. How could we make that even more unusual? Is there some way you could create a snowman in the summer or in the heat? But yeah, absolutely. You could write something that's really, really cool about that. Now, what we're going to do next is we're going to apply this these ideas to metaphors. I should say before we go any further, there is a problem with being original and weird. I don't speak to the younger years about this, but here's the problem. If you go too far, if you're like really, really amazingly original, the problem you can have is that the audience can't understand what you're saying. It can be a bit confusing. We have to have one word, I think, that helps us lock in our original ideas and connect with a reader or an audience. And that word is truth. Okay, now I think my board games rap had originality because no one else has really rapped about board games. But I think also one thing that really helped was there was truth in there. It's true that I really, really, really love board games. I've got over 100 board games. It's mad downstairs. There's so many of them. And so I think there was like a level of truth within the writing, which made it easier for people to connect with. Now I'm going to give you guys a task today, which is going to be looking at metaphor. And metaphors require, I think, some truth to be done well. So I'm hoping that everybody by now has looked at metaphor and feels comfortable with them, just in case we need a refresher. So a metaphor is a word or a phrase that's not like a simile, so we don't use the word like and we don't use as. But if I was to say, for example, that the sun is a burning meatball, that would be a metaphor. The moment I say the word meatball, I'm saying that it is something that it is not. If I said that you guys were a bunch of horrible goblins, that's mean and it's not true. It would be a metaphor and not a very pleasant one to use. Okay, so that is the point of a metaphor, is to tell you that something is something else. Now, we could say that the sun was a burning sausage. We could say that, and that would be a really original metaphor that no one else would have thought of, which is great. But I think it's harder to see the truth in that metaphor than meatball. Meatball is round like the sun, and so we can kind of see how it connects. If we say sausage, suddenly, like, we lose a little bit of the truth, I think. Absolutely. Call of Duty is not a board game, Rob. Thank you. Yeah, it doesn't count towards the count. Very good. But anyway, yeah, sorry. So that's what we need to focus on, is when we give a metaphor, we not only say something that no one has ever heard before and is unusual and is interesting, but when we hear it, we go, oh, that's kind of true. There's a very famous metaphor, which is that the eyes are the windows to the soul. And that was written during a war, right? During a huge war. And when it was written, that was a combination of words that was original. It was the first of its kind. No one had thought of it before. But when everyone heard that phrase, the eyes are the windows to the soul, they kind of thought, oh yeah, that's true, right? And the reason we still remember that line of poetry, that the eyes are the windows to the soul, is because there's so much truth in it. And for me, that's a really, really fantastic metaphor. An example of combining words that no one had thought to combine before, that when you read it out, it's original and new, but it's also true. So this is what we're going to focus on today. I'm going to give you three metaphors. I want you to see what you can come up with. It's really important to me. These metaphors are not just one word. I think, like, that's a bit easy. You guys can go further than this. I want you to try and give the most vivid, powerful metaphors you can think of. Your very first metaphor is going to be this. The moon is a what? What can you say the moon is? And I want you to finish this sentence. I don't want you to finish it with one word. I think you can finish it with two or more words. What could you say that the moon is? There's a little trick that some writers use called an eyeball kick. This is kind of cool. You can take a dictionary, open it to two random pages, and just read out what you get. And you should get an unusual metaphor that can give you like a bit of an idea or a head start. So I might say, oh, that's kind of cool. Okay. So the moon is a dazzling chandelier. That's what I got from picking up a dictionary and opening to two random pages. The moon is a dazzling chandelier. That's pretty good. Can you do better? I like cheese ball already. I'll give you 1 minute. What can you say the moon is? If you're feeling ambitious, extend the metaphor as well. The moon is a what? Keep talking about it. See how far you can go with this metaphor. What does it do? What's it? What's the next stage? It is a good second sentence, but off you go. See how you do. Oh, now we're cooking. We've got some great ideas. Now, if you found this difficult, do not worry. This is hard, I think, like to get these. But these, some of these are great. I'm just going to read out a couple of them that we got. The moon is a giant tub of vanilla ice cream. I really like that. I can see the truth because of the vanilla being the same kind of color, the creaminess of the moon. I like that. Yeah, I really like it as well. I like the giant as well, really kind of like makes me think that connects it. The moon is a unique rubber. I love that a lot. I've never heard that combination of words before. That is fully original. Well done. The moon is a cheese ball. I feel like I get the word cheese a lot in relation to the moon. So it's bordering on, it would be, if you just said like the moon is cheese, I think that would have been quite cliche. But as soon as we start to be more specific, moving to the ball, wicked. We're moving now in a direction that means it's more likely we're going to say something that's exciting. The moon is a holy biscuit. Lovely. The moon is a spotlight shining down on the theater of our lives. Mwah! Wow, that's amazing. Now, look. The metaphor is your greatest opportunity, I think, as a writer, when you're writing a description, to put your stamp on an image or an idea. Nothing really, I don't think, has the same kind of level of impact. Bearing in mind, when you move on to GCSE and we're trying to write about things creatively and descriptively, we get a very short amount of time to give an initial impression to an examiner. And if we can chuck in a metaphor that's really striking and powerful to set the scene, that's very original and unique, we immediately get our examiner thinking, oh, we're working at a much higher level. All right, so well done. This next one is big, though. This is the next one. If you write this, you can nail this. People will sit and argue in pubs about what you meant. You know, they'll be like, oh, so clever, so rich. So here we go. Can you come up with a metaphor for this? My mind is a... what? Lovely to see so many ex-students on here as well. Gosh, aren't we getting old now? My mind is a what? What can you say your mind is? I think when my mind is stressed, it's a very different thing from when it's relaxed. I ran this eyeball kick a second ago, and I got my mind is a gangster pancake, which is, I kind of like, it's pretty weird. Can you do better? What can you say your mind is? And feel free to extend it. Katie absolutely smashed it with hers. See how you do. 1 minute. Thank you. bubbling bath bomb is very good. Oh, bomb blown by all this English. Okay. Oh my goodness. Now we're cooking on gas. You got some smart cookies here. Right. Okay. These are fantastic. So I'm going to have a look at some of these. The bottom of a glowworm for a start for the moon. Nice. Deep caramelized creme brulee. The moon is deep caramelized creme brulee. I think that's a beautiful way to start a piece of writing. Okay. Let's go into the mind. Right. My mind is a bomb blown by all this English. I love it. I love the alliteration within the B's that are being used. But my mind is a bomb blown by all this English. I think it's a great line. I love the rhythm of it. It sounds lovely on the tongue. I perform a lot of my work, so I often think about how things sound. For me, when I hear people reciting poetry and things, it's almost like I'm hearing a pinball machine, and I love hearing the techniques. I kind of hear like these kind of like ding 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 as they move around, and that's got loads of little dings. My mind is an encyclopedia of my character. Woo! Lovely. My mind is a bowl of spaghetti, messy and jumbled. I think, Brandon, I absolutely, that was my mind as we started this workshop. I'm kind of locking down into it now. But yeah, that's totally good. Realistic. My mind is a fervent chest of undiscovered treasures. I mean, phenomenal use of the word fervent there. My mind is a game of Jenga. Like it. And do you know what? I like sometimes a long one is beautiful, and sometimes just like a really short one is lovely. Now, we're kind of creating a bit of a poem here as a group, right? My mind is a waterfall.